Good morning, family of God, those scattered around the Minnesota Great River region. We thank you for joining us from your location, and we trust your time with us is fruitful this morning as we grow closer to God. We trust it is for you as well as a result of it. And I want to begin by letting you know that our leadership met last Wednesday, and we've decided that we will reopen our doors for Sunday worship services here next Sunday, May 31st and on. Lord willing. And we understand that though it's important to submit to governing authorities, in most cases, even in the events that they keep, in the event that they keep us from the most God-honoring expression of love and devotion towards Him and His church, we must obey God rather than men, from Acts 4:19. And we believe that when you come to Christ, you have already counted the cost and hopefully calculated the risk that is involved with following Him, no matter what. And many churches around the world, we understand, are risking far more than even us in gathering together in Christ. So we are not compelling you to come, but we believe that adult Christians should be mature enough to consider the risks as to whether you should come or worship or not. And so we do not want to go against your convictions and your faith by remaining closed. And that being said, we still want to take a number of safety precautions and act in good faith towards the many of our recommended government guidelines. So here are the policy procedures that we will have as of next Sunday, May 31st. If any of you are feeling sick, such as a temperature, cough, or other, you should stay home for the benefit of the church. And if you are considered at risk with age or respiratory problems or other health concerns, we want you to think twice about whether you should take that risk and be here. Of course, I would still be happy to visit you where you're at as well. And we will seek to maintain a 6-foot distancing unless you already live together, although we will not be enforcing this with an iron fist, of course. We just want you to respect other people's wishes as well. We ask all attenders to bring their own Bibles and their own writing materials, whichever ones you would normally use. In the sanctuary area here, there will not be bulletins or Bibles provided, or hymnals, or pens or pencils, or other literature. You will provide your own for this task. And we will be providing masks here at the entrance of the sanctuary in case you don't have one and wish to have one. They are not high-tech, and they are designed to be simple use, a single use. We will not require it, but we want to let you decide that for yourself. We will have a person opening the front door for everyone. The sanctuary will be cleaned and sanitized before each Sunday service. The offering plate will not be passed around. There will be plates available at the exit on the way out when the service is over. And there will also be, of course, a method to give online through our church website, which is elkriverbaptistchurch.org. Some of the precious previous church programs will not be available until further notice. That includes Sunday school, nursery, coffee fellowship. And we want to emphasize that parents will be completely responsible for their kids on all these safety considerations. There will be prayer meeting tonight on Zoom at 6:30, but on the 31st, we'll begin to have prayer meeting here with the same guidelines that Sunday evening. And finally, on the 7th of June, we will partake of communion, but it will look different. And we'll have individuals coming up in a single line and to take the elements and going down another row in order to spread and we'll spread out the elements to avoid us touching each other's portions. So again, we strongly advise you to think through these things and decide whether you wish to attend here with us. As we know, there are always risks, but in this case, not all in the state government are on board with it. And that being said, I hope to see you here, and I hope to worship along with you. And as your pastor, I will bear the responsibility for this, whatever comes. I've been in touch with three senators who have been fighting for our religious freedom in our state, along with 100 Minnesota pastors that are deliberating on how to lead their congregations at this time. I will be reaching out this week to the mayor and to the local law enforcement, who we've had pretty good relationships with so far in Elk River churches. And one last comment. We lost a great man this past week to this earth, who had been extremely influential in my own life, particularly when I was a single missionary after college in the late 90s in Japan. His name is Ravi Zacharias. And Ravi Zacharias, a man from India who came to the Lord on a bed of suicide, he was used mightily by God around the globe, especially with raising up young leaders to take up the mantle and spread the gospel onto the next generation. So may we also see many young people rising up like this Ravi, who's prepared to give a defense for the faith that they have. I invite you to read along with me, if you have it in your Bibles, Psalm 106, verses 1 through 5, which says, "Praise the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare his praise? Blessed are they who maintain justice and who constantly do what is right. Remember me, O Lord, when you show favor to your people. Come to my aid when you save them, that I may enjoy the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may share in the joy of your nation and join your inheritance in giving praise." Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we will praise you. Through the storms and through the good moments, we pray that our hearts would be authentically desiring by your Spirit to give you the praise and worship you fully as you are fully deserving. Lord, we lift up those around us who may be struggling at this time. We lift up our own. We lift up Josh Tokar recovering from surgery, and for any future developments on his side. Lord, we pray for Jenny Van Epps, that you would strengthen her during this difficult time. We pray for Ella, and we ask, Lord, for many of those who are shut in at their homes, that they will be enabled by your Spirit to give you the praise and worship you where they're at. And Lord, I pray for the reopening of your church here in this place, that we would be glorifying to you, that we would give our heart, soul, mind, and strength, because only you are worthy of this praise. We pray on behalf of churches around our nation, for churches around the world who are struggling through difficult times of persecution and also with this coronavirus. We ask, Lord, that they would maintain their witness, even have a greater witness as a light shining on a hill, as the salt of the earth. May we come alongside them in solidarity and in purpose by the same Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for guiding this time together, and would you prepare our hearts and minds to receive your word and to act accordingly. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Good morning, Elk River Baptist Church. We are here today. We are going to bring you some joy. We have some songs that I've been praying all week that it lifts your spirit and that it kind of centers us in the joy that we get to live. That is Jesus Christ. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for calling us and showing yourself to us that we are yours. Let us take this joy. Let it just spill out onto everybody that we run into, letting them know that there is something special about us. And what is special about us is that we know you. We know our Savior. Let this time just be that. Let this be a joyful noise to you, Jesus. We love you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
From heaven to earth to show the way from Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
we pray today that what we bring before you, Lord, is a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Bless this time we have together. Fill us with more of your knowledge and more of your word. Let us dwell in it for the whole week. Lord Jesus, it's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
But again, good morning, family. I do invite you to open up your Bibles and read with me Revelations chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. Again, Revelations chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. This message will be a little different than the usual ones, the nature of our opening again. And so I would like to read from this passage and consider it in light of all the other factors as well. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, "These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name." This is the word of the Lord. And we live in very fascinating times, don't we? We are hounded constantly by contradicting messages every minute, proclaiming things like peace and safety for you. And it would be overwhelming if our lives were not truly grounded in the Word of God at these times. In many states like our own, efforts to extend the lockdown have continued, all in the name of peace and safety. And as I'm writing this, the announcement just came in from Camp Lebanon that they had just moved to close down their camps for the summer. It arrived in my inbox. And so with even the elections looming in November, authorities in our own state of Minnesota have strongly urged us to stay at home, citing the best of intentions and health for our communities. And I have no desire here to get political, but as politics have moved their way into our sphere of the church gatherings, I must respond, seeking to give you some spiritual considerations for a worldview that includes our purpose for living, our God-given mandates for the church, and our current religious freedoms. We are told by our state governor over 2 months ago to strongly consider closing our doors for a month or so to protect our people from the largely unknown effects of the coronavirus. Even though we're told now by the governor's office that he never officially closed the churches, and the language surrounding the religious gatherings is still ambiguous. But after over two months, and several extensions to that order to stay home, he has given a timeline that flipped to allow for bars and restaurants to open first, with no specific date given yet to churches, other than allowing for up to 10 people and strongly recommending us not to sing. Now, we have the situation in our nation where certain states are giving their churches the freedom to open while other states are not. And many churches have opened by the blessing of their state governors while other churches still closed, and still others are closed to never reopen again. There are differences across denominational lines, although you should know that the Archdiocese of Minnesota had sent a letter to our governor last week stating that the Catholic churches in their jurisdiction will open this week on May 26th. Our president just yesterday or day before yesterday specifically gave us also the order to the governors to open up. And also we have been hearing about the observance from European nations in actually forbidding their churches from participating in the Lord's Supper. Many churches will have gone for months without it, without celebrating the Lord's Supper, this command that Jesus specifically gave us. And European nations are saying, don't do that at all. For a lot of churches, that's not a big deal, even though Jesus' words were very clear on that from even 1 Corinthians 11, verse 25, where he says, "After supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again.'" This is a big deal. It is a central aspect of our worship. I know many churches observe it every week, those who are not closed down, of course. And if there are positive things coming out of this lockdown, perhaps one would be a significantly increased appreciation for the Lord's Supper and its importance. And I preached on that way back last fall, if you want to go back and listen to that. But there has been a fundamental change in our culture regarding this reverence that we should have towards these things that have been around for two centuries, even two millennia in church history. So worship was largely centralized around the Lord's Supper. And being out of a congregational fellowship was something that nearly everyone sought to avoid. They didn't want to be cast out of fellowship. There's been a considerable change here as to the nature of the relationship between church and state, and which has been happening. It's just that these shutdowns have turned the light on as to this. This is considered by many theologians today to be post-evangelicalism, identifying that the reality of our laws and institutions are still marked by the evidence of Christian faith, while the vast majority of people in our society no longer embrace that faith, nor understand why the laws have been put in place to begin with. So these changes, they didn't just happen overnight. This pandemic has merely blown the dust off this table, supporting the Constitution, which has largely been ignored. So once we gather again in large groups, we will see that much of our society has changed. Even as so many groups have resorted to online meeting methods, we should not be surprised if many of them, like church conferences, become that way permanently. Increased technology with perhaps a decreased trust of each other or unwillingness to go through the actual hassle of actually coming here in person will change the way we regard each other. So the definition of live gatherings now indicates something that is like this, a simultaneous involvement regardless of whether you are actually here or not. And this also spills over into the church. Those who once chose to stay at home for safety's sake may eventually elect to stay home for convenience sake, not realizing all that's lost in translation. I'm not prophesying this. I can see it happening. There's a panic mentality where people must wear face masks whenever they leave the home, but let's not get into that right now. The point is, things have changed. Hopefully, we can still come around the table and talk about these things together without overly emotional reactions. As I've met with many, many pastors in our area and in Minnesota weekly via Zoom over the past few weeks, we can see the distinctions in what is driving them theologically, and we can respond to these mandates in how they respond to these mandates from our state and these ever-changing requests from our state. Starting with just wash your hands regularly. Two, don't leave your home, not even if you have to mow your lawn. Many morphing of laws and orders. And so, deacons and elders and pastors have been forced to consider these things. And the first item that is almost always considered is how do we love our neighbor? From Leviticus 19:18. And in many circles and many denominations, that would mean to them to simply shut down your church. And if you don't, you must hate the community around them. You're letting the curve spike and you're passing on the virus to others. This is the paradigm that's often being promoted. It's passed on through the media. It's making very little consideration as to the long-term emotional and spiritual needs of the congregants. It would be assumed that you could gain just as much by being there virtually, and perhaps saying that's even better since you aren't necessarily held accountable in your Christian walk either. You see, there were no seminary classes that taught this. Or maybe I missed it. And now every church has to address it, and then we were given very little time to think these things through carefully. Many sources with guidelines are available, but many of them are very few of them are truly considering the long-term repercussions due to closing. Someone once told me that once you close, it is very hard to reopen again. And the longer you close, the harder it will be to reopen. I discovered that different denominations consider the role of church and state differently. And this results in a range of responses to government orders. But conservative Baptist denominations have long been distrusting of governors' intentions or things that affect churches. We understand that the world without Christ cannot understand the things of Christ. It is foolishness to them, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Power over people has the proclivity to corrupt people in power. So when they ask us to close for just a few weeks, do they sincerely have the best in mind for us in asking us to close? I understand that some governors have directly called pastors of certain large churches in our nation, asking them at the beginning to close, saying something along these lines: the best information we have is that the virus could kill millions of people in a short time, based on this one study out of the Royal College of Medicine and their models. It's now known as the Panicsville study. But most governments fell in line with that, and these fear-based models have been shown to largely be off by many factors, but the methods still go on. So just imagine getting a call from your governor asking you to consider closing for just a few weeks and just switch to online. By doing so, you would greatly encourage others to do so as well. Please help your state and your country by doing just that. If you were asked this by your authorities, what would you do? Almost no one had a written statement on this kind of thing beforehand. And few people carefully and think about the relationship here between church and state and the importance of that on our corporate worship and what is missing in online versus in-person worship. And how long can one substitute one for the other? And how important is this face-to-face fellowship? And what about the biblical commands on the matter and how they stack up against what the world is telling us? For many, if not most, evangelical churches, our separate convictions on these matters have not been challenged as to how they fit together. Well, certainly in America, where many churches have flags on their stage, isn't it their patriotic duty to do all that the nation asks of them, particularly when it means that they are saving lives? Isn't that loving your neighbor, right? So churches can also have people within with differing opinions. So the question is, can we be the church of God and also disagree at times with things like this? And if you disagree, if you happen to disagree with the leadership decision, can you still operate under that leadership? One thing we don't need at this time are more fractures within the church or even new denominational divisions based on do gather and don't gather theology and so on. Similar things have happened in church history, particularly with state-led religions. And then 100 years after that point, very few understand why they even split. We don't need that now. So I think of Hebrews 10:25 again, which says, "Let us not give up meeting together. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." This passage really has more to do with the purpose of the individual in relationship to the church, though it does show us the proper mentality of prioritizing the gatherings above other things as well in our lives. It does have the idea of church authority, and many today have really a hard time grasping that the church would have authority over individual believers. or found in the very structure of the church and the offices of the elders and deacons that are given and the ministry of the word in the church. And many church divisions have resulted from bad authority in the church. And so they may be reluctant to have the church have any authority, or they may avoid membership for that very reason. But those in Hebrews here were likely refusing that apostolic exhortation to gather together. So many people think that just a personal relationship with Jesus is enough, even though he is the head of the church and he is the one who gathered them together to be the church. So this is just saying that there is a prioritized regular meeting of the church. And it does say that as far as it depends on you, don't absent yourself from it. Of course, there are illnesses and things that would be a good reason to absent yourself for a time. But this is also regarding individuals who are not in submission to their calling as members of the body of Christ. And here's the apostolic example of the very first church of Jerusalem in Acts 2:42. Many of you know this passage well. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer, which we have on our wall here at church. I also ask you to consider Colossians 3:16. Let the word of God dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. So don't let the government dictate your corporate praise to God. And also, 1 Timothy 4:13 says, until I come, Paul speaking to Timothy, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching, and to teaching. So there we have the apostolic witness in the Word of God. You may gain some of these elements online, but not all. And throughout church history again, Christians have longed for that community from the church body. And it says something about our society that has been lost in the majority, that we do not desire it as much. For centuries, it was a terrible thing to be excluded from that community. Nowadays, you can just about do a Google search and find another nominal church near you to go to, or just watch a service on your phone. The inclusion and the exclusion, they mean something far different today to our world today. But we must be careful. We must be careful here. I'm not saying that all those who meet and worship online are sinning. Of course not. We offer that to you right now. But we want you to always test your motivations in light of God's word. But what I am saying is that as part of the body of Christ, we must all seek to grow in connection with one another, exploring our spirit-given gifts that are given for the purpose of building up the church for a reason. We can't just operate from home forever. We can't use all of your gifts at the same time. But this recent pandemic has led the majority of those in churches to believe that loving your neighbor means staying home. Is it? Something we are increasingly questioning now as a church around Minnesota, even around the world. We can use the increased opportunities from an online presence to reach the world that are shut in. But we must also all be eventually plugged into true community that seeks to grow deeper and deeper by the day. That involves some face-to-face. And as we've been going through Romans 14 and 15 together, we also see the church consists of believers with different convictions, and we must be willing to accept them, to build them up and sacrifice for their good. We must be willing to accommodate believers who have the conviction that we need to gather again, and also believers who feel the need to stay at home at this time, encouraging them to grow as much as they are able where they're at. There are other Christians and churches operating with biblical convictions as best they can, and they may arrive at different conclusions based on their resources and their needs. So let's be careful not to judge them on that. There are churches with more elderly folk and may deal with this differently than churches with mainly younger. It may depend on the age and the experience of their pastors. And if a different pandemic should arrive in the future, affecting different people, different age groups differently, such as the younger kids, we will respond differently to that with the wisdom God gives. And we can have God-glorifying discussions on this, even if we disagree. But there must be room for us to gather as a church to explore these things together and to see how our responses across the nation has affected us, how churches change as a result of this. And we can even get in trouble with a lot of people who operate emotionally. But there are churches across this nation who are continuing to meet, even at this time, through the pandemic, with their governors asking them to show caution, but not prohibiting them. Others have fought legal battles, even arrests. I think of Pastor Shiflett this last week of the 400-member Calvary Baptist Church in Maryland, who held a Wednesday night service with over 100 congregants in their 600-capacity building. And Calvary was in compliance with the Governor Hogan's orders, but they was in defiance of Baltimore County Department of Health and Human Services order. But the pastor says this: either we have liberty to worship or we have permission to worship. It has become abundantly clear that if we settle for permission, we will never have liberty again. The pastor doesn't plan on budging here. He says, I don't plan on shutting the church. If they fine us, I'm not paying it. It's unconstitutional. They don't have a leg to stand on. That's one church. There's also a network of 3,000 California churches right now, representing 2.5 million members who plan to defy the Governor Gavin Newsom's orders by resuming in-person services, as pastors there insist that they've been left out of the whole process. The California Church United pastors announced Thursday in front of a Fontana megachurch, they plan to open May 31st instead of waiting for stage 3 where gyms and movie theaters and other venues open. May 31st was chosen by them because it is Pentecost Sunday. It is marking the birth of a Christian church when the Holy Spirit descended upon the disciples, the apostles, the followers of Jesus. And it was fitting as a rebirth of services for them. Danny Carroll, a senior pastor at Walter Life Community Church, says that our churches are part of the answer, not part of the problem. We're an essential part of this whole journey, and we've been bypassed, kicked to the curb, and deemed unessential or non-essential. But after myself meeting online with 3 Minnesota senators and over 100 Minnesota pastors who also wish to reopen, and after meeting with the deacons this past week to deliberate these things, we also decide to reopen next Sunday, May 31st, Lord willing. And though the office of the governor denies at this time that Governor Walz has ever officially closed our churches across the state, he has largely been against churches reopening, and he has not stated positively regarding the majority of the Senate requesting that he do so. They also believe that he has overreached on his emergency peacetime powers, and they have stated that as such to him. I also believe that the Constitution continues to grant us the freedom of worshiping together, and I would be accountable to you and God for keeping our doors closed. I am prepared to take whatever heat comes my way from meeting together. And I think of the evangelical churches in China who together wrote a letter to Caesar, a statement to their communist government reminding them where their authority comes from. They said in an official unified statement, in essence, they said this: if you were to govern as you say you'll govern, then we would be the best citizens in China. But you must know that Jesus Christ is Lord and has authority over you. And so repent and turn to the Lord. Many of those pastors are in prison right now. There are certain aspects of this life that they, the government, have no authority over. They have no authority to tell us how to worship. They have no authority to tell us that we cannot sing. Again, I think of Acts 4, verses 18 through 20. Peter and John, they called them in again, commanded them not to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. For we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard." So fall's coming as well after summer. Winter's coming after that. We don't know if there are going to be future waves of this virus, and our government has even projected certain aspects of this virus to last months longer, even to 2022. They're saying, what if, and what if, and what if? Anything can be thrown at us. We can't afford not to meet then as Christians. And it is not ungodly to distrust the authorities of this world, even as we seek to obey them as much as we can while obeying God above them. The greatest danger to an authoritarian structure of government is a group that believes that there is a higher government above them. That's why the Communist Party of China is fearful of both Christians and Muslims. And China's cracking down on them at this time because they talk back. They say to the government, "You are not God." With all of our rich history in this nation, we should also be prepared to take what may come. A letter to Caesar from us would remind them where their authority is derived from, the limitations it has on our lives, and where that authority ends. Of course, the government wants your whole heart, but so does God. So who do you follow first? Does that mean that we take every unnecessary risk? No, of course not. We believe that we can make modifications in our church to show that we properly care for our members, and we do meet in a way that honors God as best we can corporately, that strengthens the fellowship and benefits our nation. We may not all be hugging and handshaking in the way that we once did, though I'm not going to force you apart for doing it. But we gather with you if you will gather with us. We also know this. Anytime in church history when Christians opened their mouths to sing, there were risks. Our American church history is largely an anomaly to that. So this is not brand new. Gathering to worship with risks involved, yes, even in 2020. Life has never been risk-free, and you can't insure everything. The very gathering of the church over the centuries may have been seen as irresponsible to many outsiders looking in. Some continue to gather at night in secret, many walking miles to church, many miles into the woods to a secret meeting location. Countless people have died, risking it all to go to church. That's a fact. And here's another fact. Living without risk in life is not living life. The question is who you're living for. We believe that God is in control. And our leadership believes here at this church that we need to gather. I just want you, members, to count the cost, to consider the risk, and decide if the fellowship of corporate worship is right for you at this time. I close with the Lord's words of authority to the church again in Revelation 3, verse 7 and 8. Again, to the church It's an angel of the church in Philadelphia write, "These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open." So Jesus says to them in verse 8, "I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name." Elk River Baptist, may we also show that same spirit, and may that describe us. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we submit before you as the ultimate majestic authority, you who brought our world into existence, who have authority and command over even our governments. And Lord, we ask that you would give us wisdom at this time to proceed in a way that glorifies you as we seek to obey your word with the convictions you give us by your Spirit. May we honor you with our words, our thoughts, our conversations, and our gatherings. May we gather corporately in order to bring you the greatest praise. I pray, Lord, for our nation, that our nation would come back to you. I pray, Lord, that you would work through the hearts of our governing authorities, our president and our governors and all those involved. Lord, I pray for your spirit to work through difficult times to bring us to the priorities that please you, having our eyes and our hearts focused upon you. So, Lord, we will worship you. We will sing to you. We will praise your name, for you yourself are worthy. You are the only one worthy of it all. So, Lord, guide your church, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, to bring you glory. And we pray this in the name of the one who submitted himself to you, who gave his life for us in obedience to you. Lord, it's in his name we pray. In his authority we pray. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, church, I do invite you to stand and sing a final hymn with us at this time, which is "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds," hymn number 560.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. The fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our ardent prayers, our fears, our hopes, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. We share our mutual woes, our mutual burdens bear, and often for each other flows the sympathizing tear. When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and hope to meet again. From sorrow, toil, and pain, and sin we shall be free, and perfect love and joy shall reign throughout eternity.
Lord, may we have that same spirit. May we desire to be together in such a way that shows that we are truly the body of Christ, as each person does their work, and by the Holy Spirit sharing our gifts with one another, may the church be built up strong and steadfast in this time with so many different things hitting us, different wind and the waves. We shall be strong, and someday we shall be perfectly free. We thank you for your blessed promises. May you go with us out there, wherever our Christian members are at, and may we shine the light of Christ and so bring you glory, apart and together again. We thank you for this time in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you and go in peace.